إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. I seek the protection and guidance of Allah against the incitement of Satan, the rejected. In the name of Allah, the most compassionate, the most merciful. All praises, worship, total submission, and obedience belongs to Allah, the Lord, the sustainer, the designer, the controller and wonderful originator of the universe. I bear witness that there is no any other deity that deserves to be served and worshipped other than the Almighty Allah. And I bear witness that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final and universal prophet sent by Allah for the salvation of the people of the world. May the peace and the blessing of Allah continue to shine upon our Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his blessed family and companions all together. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I greet you with the best greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. On behalf of the Islamic Propagation Center, IPC Warri, in collaboration with the management of DSP, Central Mosque, the management of the DSP Central Mosque, we are highly delighted to have been given this precious and golden opportunity through this forum in this blessed month of Ramadan in order to present a lecture entitled The Concept of God in Islam and in Christianity. What is the concept of God? Who is God? As far as Islam and Christianity are concerned, as far as the Bible and the glorious Quran are concerned. First and foremost, we thank the Almighty Allah for making us to witness this blessed month of Ramadan. And we pray that the Almighty Allah will continue to accept our worship and forgive us our shortcomings. The things we committed before, you know, and what we committed even in this blessed month of Ramadan, may the Almighty Allah have mercy on us and forgive us by the blessing of the month of Ramadan. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters in Islam, this lecture is not only meant for the Muslims, but is also meant for the non-Muslims. As Allah says in the Holy Quran, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ فَمِنْكُمْ مُؤْمِنٌ وَمِنْكُمْ كَافِرٌ
هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ فَمِنْكُمْ مُؤْمِنٌ وَمِنْكُمْ كَافِرٌ
Allah said, He is the one that created you, whether you are a believer or disbeliever. Among you, there are believers, and among you, there are disbelievers. Now, we want to know the identity of this God that created us. Who is Allah? who is God? The Christian point of view about the attributes and the nature of God is quite different from the Muslim point of view. And also, the Christian point of view about the nature and the attributes of God is quite different from the biblical point of view. Meaning, why the Bible, you know, is headed towards the west about the concept of God, the Christians are headed towards the east. Meaning, they have differed. But the Bible agrees with the Quran with respect to the identity of the Almighty God, who God Almighty is. First and foremost, in the Quran chapter 3 verse 64, Surah Al-Ali Imran, the Almighty Allah says, قل يا أهل الكتاب
قل يا أهل الكتاب تعالوا إلى كلمة سواء بيننا وبينكم ألا نعبد إلا الله ولا نشرك به شيئا ولا يتخذ بعضنا بعضا أربابا من دون الله فإن تولوا فقولوا اشهدوا بأننا مسلمون.
الله said, قل سي يا أهل الكتاب, O you, the people of the scriptures, the Jews and the Christians, تعالوا قم إلى كلمة سواء بيننا وبينكم أن لا نعبد إلا الله. Come to a common agreement, a common guidance, a common word as between us and you. Allah na'abud illa Allah, that we should serve and worship only one Allah. Wa la nushrika bihi shay'a, and that we should not in any way ascribe or associate any partnership to the Almighty Allah. Wa la yatakhidha ba'duna ba'dan arbaba min dunillah, and that one of us shall not raise an object of worship or patron beside the Almighty Allah. For in common law, that if they turn away and refuse to accept the truth, the true concept of God, for all shadu the anna Muslimun, then say, bear witness that we are Muslims. This indicates that the Almighty Allah commanded the Muslims to invite the non-Muslims, especially the Christians, to believe in the right concept of the Almighty Allah. Why did Allah give us this command? The reason is that the Christians, you know, have corrupted the true nature and concept of the Almighty God as presented in the original scripture, the Torah of Moses, meaning the law of Moses, as well as the doctrine of Jesus alayhi salam, by believing in what they call the dogma of Trinity. The dogma of what? The dogma of Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Meaning they have divided God into three portions. Title: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And in explaining this inexplicable mystic dogma called Trinity, they say that the Father is God, the Son, Jesus, according to them, is God, and the Holy Spirit is God. Yet they are not three gods, but one God. The Father is a person, the Son is a person, the Holy Spirit is a person, yet they are not three persons but only one person. The Father is the Creator, the Son is the Creator, the Holy Spirit is also another Creator, yet they are not three Creators but only one Creator. The Father is a person, the Son is a person, the Holy Spirit is a person, yet they are not three persons but only one person. We say, what are you saying? We don't understand this language. The Father is God, the Holy Spirit is God, the Son is God, yet they are not three but one God. Where do you find that in the Bible? Where do you find that
in the teaching of Jesus alayhi salam, that there are three gods in one, or one God in three, and all these gods, meaning there is no difference between Jesus and God, there is no difference between Jesus and the Holy Spirit, there is no difference between the Holy Spirit and God, and there is no difference between, you know, Jesus and the Holy Spirit. All of them are one and the same thing. They are co-eternal, they are co-equal, they are of the same essence, you know, perfection. This is what the Christians call Trinity. And other Christians went further to add Mary, the mother of Jesus, as a goddess. And they stigmatized Mary as a goddess. And also the mother of who? The mother of God. Which means that the Christians could not differentiate between Jesus Christ and God. Whenever the Christians talk about God, you know, they have Jesus in their mind. Whenever they call Lord, they have Jesus in their mind. Lord with capital L-O-R-D. That Jesus is what? Jesus is Lord. That is the reason why we are here today, to pinpoint the truth within the context of the Bible and the Quran. First and foremost, before we quoted what the Bible says, let us see how the Almighty Allah debunked the dogma of Trinity as believed by the Christians. لَكَرْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ
ثَلَاثَةٍ وَمَا مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ إِلَّا إِلَٰهٌ وَاحِدٌ وَإِنْ لَمْ يَنْتَهُوا عَمَّا يَقُولُونَ لَيَمَسَّنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ
لَكَلْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثَةٍ. They are unbelievers, those who say that indeed Allah is one of the triune God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. You know? لَكَلْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثَةٍ وَمَا مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ إِلَّا إِلَٰهٌ وَاحِدٌ. There is no any other God except only one God. That is the meaning of what? La ilaha illallah. There is no any other God except only one God. You know? Wa illam yantahu amma yaqulun. If they desist not from what they are saying, meaning, if they did not stop from their blasphemy of saying that three gods exist in one and one God exists in three, لَيَمَسَّنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. A heavy chastisement will touch them from the Almighty Allah. أَفَلَا يَتُوبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ.
أَفَلَا يَتُوبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ.
Allah said, أَفَلَا يَتُوبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Will they not turn to Allah and ask for His forgiveness? To return to Allah, وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَهُ, and ask Allah to forgive them. وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. And Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. This indicates that the Almighty Allah wants them to abstain from their blasphemous utterances that God existed in three forms: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And also in the Holy Quran chapter 4, Surah Al-Nisa'i, verse 171 to 172, Allah says, Ya ahal al-kitab, la taglu fi dinukum, wa la taglu ala
Allah. Ya ahal al-kitab, la taglu fi dinukum, wa la taglu ala Allah illa al-haqq. إنما المسيح عيسى بن مريم رسول الله وكلمته ألقيها إلى مريم وروح منه فآمنوا بالله ورسوله ولا تقولوا ثلاثة انتهوا خير لكم إنما الله إله واحد.
Another warning from the Quran. Allah said, Ya Ahad al-Kitab, O you, the people of the scripture, the Jews and the Christians. La taglu fi dinukum. You should not exaggerate in your religion. You should not go beyond the boundary of the teaching of the Bible and the Torah of Moses and the gospel of Jesus in James. وَلَا تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْحَقِّ. Don't say anything against God except the truth. إِنَّمَا الْمَسِيحَ إِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Allah said, indeed, Jesus, the son of Mary, is only a messenger from the Almighty Allah. We will come back to that. You know, وَكَلِمَتُهُ أَلْقَهَا إِلَى مَرْيَمَ. And his word, which he bestowed or cast into Mary. وَرُومِنُهُ. And a created soul of Allah, a spirit proceeding from the Almighty Allah. Meaning, Allah created the soul of Jesus, as we are going to see. You know, فَآمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرْسُولُهُ. وَلَا تَقُولُوا ثَلَاثَةً. You should not say, ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثَةً. Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That is a wrong concept of God. In Tahu Kairan Lakum, stop it, it is better for you. In Namad Lahu Elahu Wahid, for there is only one Allah, there is only one God. The Quran says there is only one God. Then what does the Bible say? Does the Bible agree with the Quran that there is only one God? Before quoting the Bible, Allah mentioned in the Quran chapter 21 that is Surah Al-Anbiya. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي
إِلَيْهِمُ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدُونَ.
Allah said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ. We do not send any of our messengers or prophets before you, O Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, illa nuhi ilayhi, except that we reveal unto him, annahu la ilaha illa ana fa'budu, that there is no any other God except myself, therefore serve and worship me. What is the meaning of this? It means that all the prophets of Allah believe in one God. Adam alayhi salam believed in one God. Enoch believed in one God. Noah believed in one God. Abraham believed in one God. Elijah believed in one God. Elisha believed in one God. Ishmael believed in one God. Isaac believed in one God. Jacob believed in one God. Jeremiah believed in one God. Ezekiel believed in one God. Job believed in one God. David believed in one God. Solomon believed in one God. Moses believed in one God. Aaron believed in one God. Jesus believed in one God. Prophet Muhammad and all the prophets that came before him believed in La ilaha illallah, that there is no any other God except the Almighty Allah. What is our evidence? First, we go to the book of Isaiah in the Bible, chapter 43, verses 10 to 11 in the Bible. This is what the Bible says. And you will see the differences between what the Bible is saying and what the Christians are preaching in the church. First, Isaiah chapter 43 verses 10 to 11. God Almighty says to the children of Israel, through the mouth of prophet Isaiah, he said, you are my witnesses, said the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me, there was no God formed. After me, there will be no God. I am the Lord. And beside me, there is no Savior. I have declared, and have said, and have shewed, when there was no strange God among you. Therefore, you are my witnesses, says the Lord, that I am God, and there is none that can deliver out of my hand. You know, this is the testimony of prophet Isaiah about the oneness of the Almighty God, that there is no any other God except Allah, that is La ilaha illallah. Then you still go back to the book of Isaiah. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 44, verse 6, he said, and I quote, I am the first, and I am the last, and there is no any other God along with me. What is the meaning of this? I am the first. Meaning, I am the first without a beginning, and the last without an ending. And there is no any other God along with me. That is Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6. I am reading the Bible, not the Quran. Then you go back to the book of Isaiah, chapter 44, verse 8. The same God Almighty says, is there any other God along with me? That is question. Is there any other God along with me? He said, no. There is no God with me. I know not any. The same thing in Isaiah chapter 45 verse 5. He said, there is no any other God along with me. Then if you go back to the book of Esdras, chapter 20, verses 2 to 5, in the Christian Bible, Esdras chapter 20, verses 2 to 5. It is very unfortunate that I have never had any Christian quoting this particular verse in the book of Esdras in order to establish the oneness of the Almighty God. That was the first commandment God Almighty gave to the children of Israel through the mouth of Moses. And this is what God said. He said, I am the Lord your God. I am the Lord your God that have brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no any other God except myself. You shall not make unto yourself any graven image in the form of idols, either in the heaven above, upon the earth beneath, or in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord your God, I am a jealous God, meaning I tolerate no rival. That is Esdras chapter 20, verses 2 to 5. Esdras chapter 20, verses 2 to 5. I am the Lord your God that I have brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You should have no any other God except myself. That is La ilaha illallah. You shall not make unto yourself any graven image of the likeness of anything, either in the heaven above, upon the earth beneath, or in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord your God, I am a jealous God. Look at God here. I am a jealous God, meaning I tolerate no rivals. You go to the book of Esdras chapter 34, verse 14 again. He said, I am the only true God, and I tolerate no rival. And you go back to the book of Isaiah, chapter 42, verse 8, again. He said, I am the only true God. I will not share my praises with any person, and I will not share my glory with any person. We are quoting the Bible. The Bible is saying, establish the existence and the unity of the Almighty Allah. You go back to the statement of Solomon. In 1 Chronicles chapter 17, verse 20, this is what Prophet Solomon said in the Bible. 1 Chronicles chapter 17, verse 20 in the Bible. He said, O God, the Lord of Israel, there is no God like you, and there is no any other God along with you, in accordance to all that we have heard with our own ears. There is no God like you, and there is no God with you, in accordance to all that we have heard with our own ears. The same thing the father of Solomon called David in 2 Chronicles chapter 6 verse 14. He said, Oh God, the Lord of Israel, there is no God like you in both the heavens and on earth. This indicates that the Bible in the Old Testament believe in La ilaha illallah. That is the Islamic testimony. There is no any other God except the Almighty Allah. Now, Jesus, what did Jesus say about God? What did Jesus say about God? First and foremost, before I quote what Jesus said about God, let us see what Allah says in the Holy Quran, chapter 5, verse 72. لقد كفر الذين قالوا إن الله هو المسيح ابن مريم.
الذين قالوا إن الله هو المسيح ابن مريم. وقال المسيح يا بني إسرائيل اعبدوا الله ربي وربكم. إنه من يشرك بالله فقد حرم الله عليه الجنة وما أويه النار.
First, before the testimony of Jesus in the Bible, you know,
Allah says in the Quran chapter 5 verse 72, لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْمَسِيحُ بْنُ مَرْيَمَ. They are unbelievers, those who say that Christ, Jesus, the son of Mary, is God. They are unbelievers, those that call Jesus God in Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They are unbelievers. وَقَالَ الْمَسِيحُ. You know, that Jesus himself said, Ya Bani Israel, oh you the children of Israel. Why did Jesus call them, oh you the children of Israel, his people? Because he was sent to them. According to the book of Matthew, chapter 15, verse 24, Jesus said, I was sent only to the lordship of the house of Israel. Meaning Jesus was sent only to his people. And he said to them, Ya Bani Israel, oh you the children of Israel, Ibudullah, worship Allah. Jesus says, worship Allah. Rabbi Barabokum, my creator and your creator. My Lord and your Lord. So Jesus invited his people to serve and worship the Almighty God. Do we have a verse in the Bible where Jesus commanded his people to worship God? Yes. First, the book of John chapter 4, verse 24. John chapter 4, verse 24. Jesus said, God is his spirit, baby, God is invisible, and he that shall worship God Almighty in spirit and in truth. Another evidence, in the book of Luke, chapter 4, verses 7 to 8 in the Bible, Luke chapter 4, verses 7 to 8, when the devil said unto Jesus, I will give you the kingdom of this world, if only you will bow down and worship me. Jesus said to Satan, the devil, get away. Get away from here, you Satan. It is written in the scripture, thou shalt worship the Lord your God, and only him shall you serve. Only who? Only him. Not pastor singular, not himself. Only him, meaning only the Almighty God shall be worshipped, according to Jesus. Did Jesus worship God also? Yes, the Bible says Jesus worshipped God. Where? In the book of Matthew, chapter 26. Verse 39, the Bible says, Jesus walked a little way farther, and he fell on his face, and he sat and worshipped the Almighty Allah, indicating that he was not God. He was not an object of worship. But Jesus sat and worshipped a God other than himself. Jesus never believed himself to be God. But instead, Jesus said, Ya Bani Israel, oh you the children of Israel, Ibudullah, worship Allah, worship God, my Lord and your God, Rabbi wa Rabbukum. Innahu man yushrik billah. Whosoever ascribe or associate any partnership to Allah, faqad harrama Allahu alayhi al-jannah. Allah has forbidden paradise for him. He will never enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the Quranic statement in defense of who? Jesus alayhi salam. Jesus said, whosoever associate or ascribe any partnership to Allah or compare Allah with anything, God has forbidden paradise for him. He will never enter paradise. Do we have any statement in the Bible where Jesus made this kind of statement? Yes. It's mentioned in the book of John chapter 17 verse 3. John chapter 17 verse 3. Jesus said, this is life eternal, that they should know you as the only true God. This is life eternal, that they should know you as the only true God, and to believe in Jesus whom you have sent. Who sent him? The only true God. That is what? La ilaha illallah. Then Jesus also, you know, reaffirmed this oneness of Allah. Oneness of Allah, where in the book of Mark, chapter 12, verses 28 to 34, Mark chapter 12, you know, Mark chapter 12, verses 28 to 34, Jesus said, the first of all, the commandment of all, is here, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, in his own language, he said, Jahweh Elohenu, Jahweh Echad. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. That was in Aramaic language, which was the language of Jesus. He said, Jahweh Elohenu, Jahweh Echad.
The Lord our God, the Lord is one. And thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your strength, with all your mind, and with all your soul. And thou shalt love your neighbor as you love yourself. This is the first commandment. And there is no any other commandment greater than this. Then the scribe asked Jesus, telling him that, yes, master, you have actually spoken the truth, in that there is only one God, and that there is no any other God except the Almighty God. And to love the Lord our God with all our heart, strength, and soul is better than burnt offering and sacrifice. Then Jesus told the scribe, he said, if actually you believe in what you say, that there is only one God in heaven, then you are not far away from the kingdom of God. You are not far away from the kingdom of God for believing in La ilaha illallah, that there is no any other God except the Almighty God. Now the Christians say there are three gods in heaven: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But Jesus says, no, there is only one God in heaven. Where? In the book of Matthew chapter 23 verse 9. Matthew chapter 23 verse 9 in the Bible. Jesus said, you should not call any person on earth as your father, for you have only one father who is in heaven. That is God. The word father is used in the Bible allegorically, parabolically, figuratively, not literally or biologically. And that word was used even before the advent of Jesus alayhi salam by the Jews. It was later that they corrupted it. You know, so when Jesus said, you should not call any person on earth as your father, meaning you should not call any person on earth as your God, he was not saying that you should not call any person your biological father and father. No, you know, that you should not call any person on earth as your God, for you have only one God who is in heaven. Therefore, Jesus also admitted that there is only one God in heaven. You know, in Nahuma Yushrik Billah, whosoever ascribes any partnership to Allah, فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. Allah has forbidden paradise for him, وَمَعَوَاهُ النَّارِ. His final destination is the hellfire. And for the evil doers, there will be no helper. If Jesus alayhi salam can be included in the Trinity formula to become God within the context of the Bible, because the Bible clearly tells us that Jesus is only a prophet of God and a servant of the Almighty God. Jesus never arrogated the power of God to himself. Jesus never claimed to be God. Jesus never believed himself to be God. And this is the evidence. First evidence, Mark chapter 15 verse 34 in the Bible, and Matthew chapter 27 verse 46 in the Bible, Jesus says, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Eli, Eli, in another version, he said, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. Meaning, my God, why have you forsaken me? Which means that Jesus was not calling himself. He said, my God. He was calling a God other than himself. So which means that Jesus believed in the existence of a God, which he addressed as my God, indicating that Jesus himself is not God. The same thing in John chapter 20 verse 17. He said, I am ascending up to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Meaning, you stood in the same relationship, you know, with Jesus as far as God is concerned. Because he said, my Father and your Father, my God and your God, my Creator and your Creator, indicating that Jesus himself is not God. Then in Mark chapter 13 verse 32, Jesus said, of that day and that hour, no one knows, not even the Son of Mary. I, Jesus, the Son of Mary, know the angels in heaven, but only the Almighty God knows when the world will end. Indicating that, you know, one of the legs of the dogma of Trinity has been broken. Because if Jesus is not God, then Trinity will not stand. Abi? If Jesus is not God, Trinity, the dogma of Trinity, will not stand. You know, then Jesus, according to the Bible, is addressed as a prophet of God. First, in Matthew chapter 21, verses 10 to 11, in the Bible, any Bible, Matthew chapter 21, verses 10 to 11, Jesus is called a prophet of God. Matthew chapter 21, verse 46, in the Bible, Jesus is called a prophet of God. You know, Matthew chapter 21, verse 46, then Matthew chapter 13, verse 57, Jesus is called a prophet of God. Luke chapter 24, verse 19, in the Bible, Jesus is called a prophet of God. Luke chapter 13, verse 33, in the Bible, Jesus is called a prophet of God. Luke chapter 7, verse 16, in the Bible, Jesus is called a prophet of God. John chapter 6, verse 14, in the Bible, Jesus is called a prophet of God. John chapter 7, you know, John chapter 9, verse 17, in the Bible, Jesus is called a prophet of God. John chapter 4, verse 19, in the Bible, Jesus is called a prophet of God. John chapter 7, verse 40, in the Bible, Jesus is called a prophet of God. Mark chapter 6, verse 4, in the Bible, Jesus is called a prophet of God. We have 10 verses in the Bible where Jesus is addressed as a prophet of God. Matthew chapter 21, verses 10 to 11. Matthew chapter 21, verse 46. Matthew chapter 13, verse 57. Luke chapter 13, Luke chapter 13, verse 33. Luke chapter 24, verse 19. Luke chapter 7, verse 40. Luke chapter 7, verse 16. Luke chapter 7, Luke chapter 7, verse 16. Then Luke chapter 24, verse 19. Then John chapter 9, verse 17. John chapter 6, verse 14. Mark chapter 6, verse 4. And John chapter 7, verse 40. Jesus is called a prophet of God. A prophet of God. A prophet of God. Can a prophet of God be God? No. So Jesus is a prophet of God in the Bible. Then the glorious Quran confirms what Jesus said. On the very day that Jesus Christ was born, when Mary brought Jesus before the assembly of the people, what did he say?
فَأَتَتْ بِهِ قَوْمَهَا تَحَمِلُهُ قَالُوا يَا مَرْيَمُ لَقَدْ جِئْتِ شَيْئًا فَرِيًّا
فَأَتَتْ بِهِ قَوْمَهَا تَحَمِلُهُ Mary, the mother of Jesus, on the very day she gave birth to Jesus, she took Jesus and she walked majestically towards her own people, you know, with a fatherless child. Hallelujah, Maryam. They say, oh, Mary, you have come with a strange thing, a new thing to all.
Ya أخت هارون ما كان أبوك امرأ سوء وما كانت أمك بغيا
يا أخت هارون أو sister of Aaron ما كان أبوك امرأ سوء وما كانت أمك بغيا your father was not a wicked man your mother was not a harlot where did you get that particular child
فأشارت إليه
She pointed to Jesus, meaning she referred them to Jesus to ask him questions.
قالوا
they say, Maryam, Mary, كيف نكلم من كان في المهد سبيا? How do you expect us to speak with a child in the cradle, a newly born baby?
قال إني عبد الله آتيني الكتاب وجعلني نبيا.
Then Jesus started speaking. Saying, Allah indeed Abdullah, indeed I am the servant of Allah. Atani al-Kitab. Allah has given me the book. Waja'alani nabiyya. Allah has meant me to be his prophet. Waja'alani mubarakan aina ma kuntu.
Waja'alani mubarakan aina ma kuntu. Wa awsini bis salati wa zakati ma dumtu hayya.
Waja'alani mubarakan aina ma kuntu. And Allah has meant me to be blessed. You know, Allah has been blessed wheresoever I may be. Wa awsani bi salati wa zakati ma dumtu hayya. And Allah has enjoined on me salat, prayer, wa zakat. I've given out of zakat ma dumtu hayya as long as I am alive. This indicates that, according to the Quran, Jesus was a servant of God. The Bible also confirmed that. Where does the Bible address Jesus as a servant of God? First, in John chapter 13, verse 16. John chapter 13 verse 16, Jesus said, the servant is not greater than his master, nor he that is sent greater than he that sent him. Second, Matthew chapter 12 verse 18, behold my servant Jesus whom I have chosen. Meaning, Jesus is called a servant of God again in Matthew chapter 12 verse 18. Then in the book of Acts of the Apostles chapter 3 verse 13, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 3, verse 26, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, verse 27, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, verse 30. These four different places. Acts chapter 3, verse 13, Acts chapter 3, verse 26, Acts chapter 4, verse 27, and Acts chapter 4, verse 30. Of the Revised Standard Version, New King James Version, New International Version, Living Bible, New American Bible, New International Bible, and the Jehovah's Witness Bible. Jesus is addressed as what? A servant of the Almighty Allah, a servant of God. Meaning, Jesus is a servant of God according to the Bible. He is a servant of God according to the Quran. Jesus is a prophet of God according to the Bible. He is a prophet of God according to the Quran. Then, Jesus is what? A human being. That the Christians say he is not a human being. If you can bear me witness, some of you that we are here at the trailer park, just about 5 days ago, a reverend father came. The first statement he uttered in order to debunk our preaching, he said, Jesus is not a human being. We say, who is he? He said, Jesus is God. He said, Jesus is not a human being, but Jesus is God. And he contradicted the Bible. Which means that they do not know the actual concept of God, the actual identity of God, the actual differences between Jesus and God. The only thing they will tell Jesus and God are one. But the Bible addressed Jesus as what? As a man, a human being in all respect. Allah says in the Quran, Mal Masih ibn Maryam.
Mal Masih ibn Maryam illa rasulun qad khalat min qablihi ar-rusul wa ummuhu siddiqa. Kana yakulan at-ta'am. Undur kayfa nubayyinu lahum al-ayati thumma undur anna yufakun.
Quran chapter 5 verse 75. Mal Masih ibn Maryam illa rasulun. Christ Jesus, the son of Mary, is a messenger from the Almighty Allah. He was sent by God. Do we have evidence in the Bible where Jesus is called a messenger of God? Yes. First, John chapter 12, verse 49, in the Bible, Jesus said, I have not spoken on my own authority, but the God who sent me gave me the commandment of what I should say and what I should speak unto you. We want the Christians to tell us which God sent Jesus, if Jesus was God. Can God send another God?
No.
No. He said, I have not spoken on my own authority, but the God who sent me gave me the commandment of what I should say and what I should speak unto you. The God who sent me. So if Jesus was sent, automatically he became a messenger of God. Then in the book of John chapter 5 verse 30, John chapter 5 verse 30, the same Jesus said, I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not of my own will, but I seek the will and the authority of the God who sent me. Which God was Jesus referring to, if Jesus himself was God? Or was he the one that sent himself? No. Then in the book of John chapter 8, verse 42, John chapter 8, verse 42, Jesus said, I did not come on my own, but he, God, sent me. Then in the book of John, chapter 7, verse 16, Jesus said, my doctrines, meaning my teachings, are not mine, but they belong to him who sent me. Then in the book of John, chapter 6, verse 38, John chapter 6, verse 38, Jesus said, I did not come on earth in order to do my own will, but I come to do the will of him who sent me. Who sent him? The Almighty God. The same thing in the book of John chapter 4 verse 34. Jesus said, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his job. The same thing in the book of John chapter 17 verse 30. Jesus said, this is life eternal, that they should know you as the only true God and to believe in Jesus whom you have sent. Sent. Jesus sent by God. Jesus sent by God. Meaning, Jesus is a messenger from who? From the Almighty Allah. Wa Rasulun ila Bani Israel. He was a messenger, a prophet from the Almighty Allah to his own people, the Jews. So this indicates that Jesus was sent by God. المسيح ابن مريم إلا رسول. Christ Jesus, the son of Mary, is only a messenger from who? From the Almighty Allah. You know? كان خالد من قبل هيروشيم. But Allah said he was not the only messenger. Other messengers and prophets had passed away before Jesus. Other prophets and messengers, you know, passed away before Jesus. And Jesus confirmed that he was not the only one. In Matthew chapter 5 verse 17 to 18, Matthew chapter 5 verse 17 to 18, Jesus said, think not that I have come away from the law till all be fulfilled, indicating that Jesus was sent, you know, in the footsteps of the prophet that we are sent before him. By who? By the Almighty God. This shows the differences between Jesus and God. God is the sender, and Jesus is the messenger. You know, وَأُمَّهُ صَدِيقَةٌ. Then the Quran says, the mother of Jesus, Mary, was a holy woman, a saint. But today, the Catholic Church, they worship Mary as a goddess. And they call her the mother of God, which means that they have not estimated Allah with the right estimation that is due to him. You know, they have not really, you know, given to Allah the true concept, you know, the true attribute of the Almighty Allah. You know, so in a nutshell, Mary, the mother of Jesus, was a holy woman. Now, in the Bible, there is no part in the Bible that called Mary the mother of God. But the Catholic call her the mother of God. There is no verse in the Bible that addresses Mary as a goddess. And you cannot find any verse in the Bible where Mary addressed her son, Jesus, by calling him God. You cannot find that place because the mother, Mary, knew. Therefore, she knew her son better than the pastor, bishop, reverend father, reverend mother, and other hot Christian evangelists. But is there any verse in the Bible where Mary, the mother of Jesus, addressed her son, Jesus, as son of God? As a Christian, we want the evidence of his mother. The mother that gave birth to Jesus, where did she address Jesus as God, or son of God? Where? Or are you telling me that you know Jesus better than his mother? No. You know? Did Mary also address herself as a goddess? No. First, in the book of Luke chapter 1 verse 38. Luke chapter 1 verse 38, Mary said, behold, I am the handmaid of God, meaning I am the servant of God. Then in the same Luke chapter 1, verses 46 to 47, Mary said, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. In God, my Savior. She did not say in Jesus, my Savior, but she said in God, my Savior. Now, another question. But before the question, let me end it back. Both Jesus and his mother, according to the Bible and the Quran, we are used to eating and drinking. They ate food. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ إِلَّا إِنَّهُمْ لَيَأْكُلُونَ
الطَّعَامَ وَيَمْشُونَ فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ.
Allah said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. We have not sent any of our messengers or prophets before you, O Muhammad. Except that they were used to eating food and they used to go to the market. All the prophets of Allah, any person that eats food, just ask this Christian, this simple question. Any person that eats food, can he be God? Meaning, because he depends on factors of production. Factors of growth and production, food. So if Jesus ate food, then he must go to the toilet. Any person that eats food must find his way to the toilet. So the Quran said Jesus ate food. As some Christians never believe that Jesus ate. But their Bible believes that Jesus ate. In the book of Matthew chapter 11, verse 19, Jesus said, I, the Son of Man, come eating and drinking. Then in John chapter 19, verse 28, Jesus said, I thirst. I needed water to drink. I thirst. Can God be thirsty? I thirst. Indicating that Jesus did not share the same quality with God. Then in the book of Luke, chapter 24, verses 41 to 43. Luke chapter 24, verses 41 to 43. Jesus asked for food from his disciples. Do you have anything to eat? And they took a piece of fish and honeycomb, and they gave them to Jesus. And Jesus started eating them in their own presence. Was it God that was eating? No. Jesus is a human being. Therefore, the nature of Jesus is quite different from who? From the nature of the Almighty Allah. You know, Allah says, وَمَا جَعَلْنَاهُمْ جَسَدًا لَا يَأْكُلُونَ الطَّعَامَ وَمَا كَانُوا خَالِدِينَ. We have not made bodies for them that ate no food, because they were all human beings. You know? And the Bible directly addressed Jesus as a human being in all respect. Where? John chapter 8, verse 40. Jesus told the Jews in John chapter 8, verse 40, you wanted to tell me, I, a human being, that I have told you the truth, which I hear from the Almighty God? Look at this difference. I, a human being, that I have told you the truth, which I hear from the Almighty God. John chapter 8, verse 40. Then in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, look at this. 1 Timothy in the Bible, chapter 2, verse 5, it is written, there is only one God and only one mediator between men and God. That is the man Christ Jesus. Meaning, there is one God, and Jesus in his time, he was a mediator, a middleman between men and God, between the people of Israel and God. He was their teacher, he was their prophet, he was their messenger. Because in Matthew chapter 15, verse 24, he said, I was sent only to the lordship of the house of Israel. So he said, there is one God and one mediator between men and God, the man Christ Jesus. Mark that word, the man Christ Jesus. Then in Acts of the Apostles chapter 2, verse 22, we want to hear the confessions and wonders which God did through him in the midst of you, as you all know. Pastor, the friendship, because some Christians are now believing that God is a human being. Like, for example, the members of the Brotherhood of the Cross and Star, founded by Olumba Obu of Kanaba, a man that lived at number 34 Ambo Street in Kanaba. They call him God. Olumba. I am telling you, they worship him. Yes, they address Olumba as God. Even Guru Maharaji, the man that lives here in the bush near Ibadan, Ibadan Express, Lagos Ibadan Expressway, they also stigmatize him as God. So many people like that, they address them as God. But is God a human being? The Bible says no. First, in Hosea chapter 11, verse 9, Hosea, H-O-S-E-A, chapter 11, verse 9, God says, indeed I am God, I am not a human being. Then in Numbers chapter 23, verse 19, the Bible says, God is not a man, and God Almighty is not the Son of Man. God is not a man, and God is not the Son of Man. Then if God is not a man, and God is not the Son of Man, and if Jesus is a man, according to the Bible, and Jesus is the Son of Man, according to the Bible, in 83 different places, then Jesus is not God and God is not Jesus. Yes. That is the difference. The difference is clear. Therefore, we urge the Christian to go and find the identity of the Almighty God. Who is God? They need to ask their pastor this question. Who actually is God? And Allah said in the Holy Quran, Quran chapter 2, Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 255, Allah la ilaha illa huwa.
Allah la ilaha illa hu. Al-Hayyul Qayyum.
Allah, Allah, the Almighty God. La ilaha illa huwa. There is no any other God except Him. The Bible confirmed that in Exodus chapter 20, verse 2 to 5. The Bible confirmed that in Isaiah chapter 43, verse 10 to 13. The Bible confirmed that in Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6. The Bible confirmed that in Isaiah chapter 44, verse 8. The Bible confirmed that in Isaiah chapter 45, verse 5. The Bible confirmed that in Mark chapter 12, verse 29, from the lip of Jesus alayhi salam. The Bible confirmed that in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, from the mouth of Moses alayhi salam. The Bible confirmed that in 1 Chronicles chapter 17, verse 20, from the mouth of Solomon. The Bible confirmed that in 2 Chronicles chapter 3, verse 14, from the mouth of David, that there is no any other God except the Almighty God. You know? Al-Hayyul Qayyum. The ever-living, isn't it? The God that never dies, the everlasting. Now, this is one of the attributes of God. He never dies. That cannot overpower God. That cannot overtake the Almighty God. God is from everlasting to what? To everlasting. He never died. The Bible confirmed that in Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 17, addressing God as the ever-living God, the everlasting God. Now we want to ask the question, is Jesus everlasting? Who are our witnesses, the Christians? What did they say? They say Jesus died. Not even he died a natural death. They say he was brutally killed. Jesus was brutalized, humiliated and disgraced on the cross. Meaning, Jesus was killed on the cross, according to the Christians. Then there is contradiction. You cannot believe that Jesus was died. Jesus died. And at the same time believe that Jesus is God. Because they are not consistent. They are incompatible. If Jesus is God, then he cannot die. But if you, the Christian, believe that Jesus died, then you are helping the Muslim to prove that Jesus is not God. It's not God. You know? So, the Bible says God never dies, and God, death cannot overpower God. That is what the Bible says. In Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 15 to 16. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 15 to 16. That God Almighty never dies. Nobody can kill God. But if you believe that Jesus was killed on the cross, then you ought to know that he is not God, according to your own belief. The Christian, that he died on the cross, then you cannot accept him as God. You know? So, لا تأخذه لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم. Neither slumber nor sleep overtake God. But what about Jesus? The Bible tells us in two places. First, Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 to 24. Second, Luke chapter 8, verses 23 to 24. They are all saying the same thing. That when Jesus was sleeping inside a ship, he was sleeping. He was sleeping. And they went and waked him up. Because he did not know what was happening in the ship. The ship wanted to be capsized, to sink. And Jesus was not aware. He was at the back of the ship sleeping. Until when they went and woke him up. So if Jesus slept, was he in his capacity as God when he was sleeping? No. He cannot be God. You know? So Allah says, لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم. Neither slumber nor sleep overtake God. God does not slumber and he does not sleep. The Bible confirmed that in the book of Psalm 124, verse 1, and Psalm 125, verse 1. He said, God neither slumber nor sleep. God neither slumber nor sleep, according to the Bible. So if God neither slumber nor sleep, and Jesus slept, how then can Jesus be God? Then the Christians must have to go and find who God is. If the Christians say that God is one, they mean what? God is three. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And at times, whenever they found themselves in melancholical situation, they pray in the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. There was a time when we were told, you know, the commercial vehicle was going to Lagos, and with the passengers, you know, as they were on the road traveling to Lagos, you know, then an accident was about to have happened. You know, the motor wanted to tumble with them. And the driver was saying, oh, Jesus, 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 Jesus. He was calling the name of Jesus. Then there was a Muslim, an uneducated Muslim, a Muslim that is not educated inside that boat. He was a Muslim, but he was also, when he had the driver and the other Christians were shouting, Jesus, Jesus. He also started shouting, Jesus, Jesus. He was a Muslim. He was shouting also, Jesus, Jesus. Then what happened? After the motor, you know, came under control, then this man was asked, we see you with this Delavia and this and even this. You are calling Jesus. Are you not a Muslim? He said, Jesus, I thought that it was the name of the driver. He said that he thought that the person that we are calling the driver's name, he thought that the name of the driver is Jesus. So he started calling Jesus. You see, so in a nutshell, the Christians do not actually know the actual concept of the Almighty Allah. Lahuma sisamawatu wa masal al. To Allah belongs what is in the heavens and the earth. Everything belongs to Allah. But Jesus on nothing. Yes, that was what Jesus said himself in the book of Matthew chapter 20, verses 20 to 22. A woman, you know, the mother of the sons of Zebedee came unto Jesus. And she requested something from Jesus. She said, Master, allow that these two sons of mine, James and John, one should sit by your right hand, the other one by your left hand, in the kingdom of heaven. Then Jesus said unto her, woman, do you know what you are asking? Can you use the cup I use in drinking to drink? She said, yes. Jesus said, you can do that. Then to sit at my right hand and at my left hand in the kingdom of heaven is not my power to grant. I have no power to grant, said Jesus alayhi salam. Is it time? Okay, that's it. Okay, we have already observed our prayer. We combine our prayer. So those that do not pray.
He said, madam, please, can you make it clearer by reading the book of John, chapter 6, verse 37, clearly? And also, the book of Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. The book of Galatians chapter 3, verse 28. I think it will be better for Pastor concept in the Christendom and in Islam, as quoted by the Sheikh in the Bible, or what? I'm reading your question, right? Yes. Please, your name, please. These are Pastor what?
I'm Pastor Jerry from Redeem.
Pastor Jerry from Redeem Christian Church of God. You're welcome, sir. Please, can you elaborate about your question?
So what I'm saying is that if you read back, okay, I've been giving some quotation in the Bible, fine. Then if you make it clearly with this one, read this place, then let it explain the difference between the Muslim concept with that of the Christian, so that I can get it clear.
Okay.
Because the point or topic of presentation is the concept of God.
So you are talking about Trinity.
Yes, I talk about Trinity.
And you know, Trinity of a thing, it's not all Christians that are following that Trinity.
Agreed. The Jehovah's Witness, do not believe in Trinity.
Yes.
The same thing with the Unitary Church of Christ. Agree.
Yes.
That some Christians.
But you don't need to make sure earlier that some Christians, you say Christians.
Yes. Do you know the reason? Because more than 95% of the Christendom believe in Trinity.
Yes.
95% of them. Those people that do not believe in Trinity, they are negligible and they are not even considered to be Christians by the other Christians, like the Jehovah's Witnesses. They are condemned by the other Christian population.
Sir,
I hope you understand.
Yes, sir. But if I can throw more light. You see, one thing I need to understand, like for we redeemed, we don't believe in Trinity.
Check me.
Allahu Akbar.
Check me.
Allahu Akbar.
Pastor Jericho?
Yes.
From Redeemed Christian Church. So you are a student of Professor Adeboye?
Yes.
I watched his program yesterday. He will not become Muslim.
Yes, I was ordained by Adeboye, which is about 14 years back.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, I want us to read that place clearly. Let's open that.
Which place? No, open it and read it. Take the Bible, whichever you want.
The book of John. The book of John.
John.
Chapter 6. John 6, 37.
John chapter 6.
John 6, 37.
John chapter 6.
Verse 37.
Verse 37.
John 6, 37.
Okay. Ready?
John 6, 37. Say, all that the Father has given me will come to me. And the one who comes to me, I will give all by me. He said, all that comes to me from God.
Yeah.
He's not comparing himself with God now. Try again this thing.
Okay, look, don't even waste your time. You have agreed that the dogma of Trinity is not a biblical teaching. And that is what you think.
Yes.
Which means that, not this everyone, you agree with me. Therefore, now it is your own responsibility as a Christian to go and convince the other Christians that believe in Trinity that the dogma of Trinity is not the teaching of the Bible. And I am quite happy and I really appreciate the fact that you have agreed that there is nothing like Trinity as far as the teaching of the Bible is what is concerned, which means that those that believe in the dogma of Trinity are not following the teaching of the Bible.
Yes, like what you rightly said, you said like that of Catholic Church,
yeah,
they honor Mary, and it is only that of Catholic Church. Like as for we redeem and the rest, we don't recognize Mary. She's just a lucky person. She's lucky in the sense that she was found worthy at that time. And that was the reason why Holy Spirit used him to give birth to Christ. Not that he is a mother of Christ. It's not a mother of God.
No, according to the Catholic, you are defending your church. Abi?
No, I'm not defending. It's I understood the thing.
No, I have been taught. Excuse me. We are saying the same thing. You don't believe in Trinity. I don't believe in Trinity. Which means that what I quoted from the Bible to debunk the dogma of Trinity, you have agreed with it.
Yes, I agree with you that.
Thank you very much. Then there is no point of argument. Then you don't believe that Mary is the mother of God, as the Catholic Church believes. And I also, as Muslim and all other Muslim brothers and sisters, do not also believe in that dogma.
Fine. So I just wanted to make it clear to you that, so that you don't fear, say maybe other people that are here, you'll be thinking the other way around, that every Christian believe that Mary is mother of God.
No, I say, I even mentioned it, I say the Catholic Church.
Okay,
I made that distinction.
Let's see that, John 6 verse 40, let's go to that 41.
John
6 verse 40.
Okay.
He said, and this is the will of him who sent me, who sent me, which is God.
Thank
that
you.
Sent Christ. This is the will of him who sent me.
Yeah.
That everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and we make and we raise him up in the last day.
Now, then what are you trying to prove here?
So what I'm telling you this place now, because you said Jesus Christ has, he don't have the power
I want to make it clear to you that it has power.
Listen. I say all the miracles that Jesus performed.
Yes, when he was alive,
when he was living on earth, raising the dead, curing the blind, healing the lepers, walking on the water, casting out demons, you know, it was not his own power.
No, he derived the power from God, it's not his own power.
Uh-huh. And I quoted to you.
So here, look, my friend, let's calm down, please.
Mr. Jerry, from the Redeemed Christian Church of Christ, one of your legs is for Islam, the other one. So remember this, let you carry a good
answer. You have not finished that. So the way you are saying, say Christ, right? I was thinking maybe you felt that Christ does not have power.
No. Moses performed miracles.
Exactly.
Elijah. Ezekiel,
yes.
Jesus,
so and so forth, yes.
Many all of the prophets of God.
Yes.
But God Almighty says in the Quran, yes. Let me put it and translate it.
Yes.
And correlate it with a verse from the Bible. He said, وَمَا كَانَ لِلْنَبِيِّ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ بِآيَةٍ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. That it is not possible for any prophet to come with any miracle except with the permission of God.
Exactly, I agree with
you. Thank you. So what we are saying in essence was, Jesus performed his miracle by the power of God. Yes. Moses performed his miracle by the power of God.
Yes.
All the prophets of God performed their miracles by the power of who?
God.
By the power of the Almighty God. You see, all the Muslims you see here, and not only here, the Muslims all over the world believe in Jesus. His name is Isa. We call him Isa Ibn Maryam. Jesus, the son of Mary. The Muslims honor them. The Muslims, you know, respect them. You know, Jesus, according to Islam, is a prophet of God and a servant of God and a messenger, meaning God sent him. No Muslim is qualified to be a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus.
Yeah.
Fine. The Muslims believe in all the prophets of God, including David, Solomon, Zechariah, John the Baptist, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Jonah, David, Solomon, and all other prophets. They are mentioned in the Holy Quran. I hope you understand difference. Because the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 1 verse 18 that, oh come, let us reason
together as one.
Exactly. We want to break the barrier between the Muslims and the Christians and create a dialogue forum where we can be able to come together and
dialogue together
to know, you know, our differences, where we differ and why we differ.
Yes, sir.
I didn't take that point.
Yes, sir.
So alhamdulillah, I thank the Almighty.
Sir, Lord. If I say ask, may I ask something? So I want to know the position of the Jesus and that of your prophet.
Prophet Muhammad.
Muhammad. So may I get that place clearly between two of them?
That is why this kind of discussion is very, very important. He wants to know the relationship between Jesus and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Okay.
So to that question, he said, whom should we honor and worship?
Let me answer his question. First, I will briefly answer you. You know Abraham. I know Abraham. Abraham is the father of the Jews and the Arabs. You get it? The first son of Abraham, according to the Bible, in Genesis chapter 16, verse 15 to 16, was Ishmael, through Hagar. The second son of Abraham came from Sarah, called Isaac. Ishmael and Isaac were brothers. I hope you understand. Of the same father, Abraham, but different mothers. Thank you very much. You get it? The descendant of Abraham through Isaac were the Jews. And the descendant of Abraham through Ishmael were the Arabs. Now, the Israelite prophethood in the line of Abraham through Isaac, like David, like Solomon, you know, like John the Baptist, Zechariah, Moses, Aaron, Jesus, descended from Abraham through Isaac, you know, through Jacob. That is why the Bible in Matthew chapter 1 verses 1 to 2 says, the book of the genealogy of Jesus, the son of Abraham, the son of David. That is from that side. Then from this side, Ishmael, Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was the last prophet that came after Jesus from the line of Abraham through Ishmael. So Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, you know, was the cousin brother of Jesus because they descended from Abraham. Jesus descended from Abraham. Prophet Muhammad descended from Abraham. And the prophethood of Prophet Muhammad was as a result of the blessings of the Almighty God conferred upon Ishmael by God in both the Bible and the Quran. Because God said he will bless Ishmael. He will make him to become a great nation. He will multiply his children abundantly that they shall not be numbered for multitude. You get it? And he will begat 12 princes. Now, the result of that blessing of God upon Ishmael, the first son of Abraham, was the coming of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Now, when Prophet Muhammad emerged after Jesus Christ, he urged the Muslims all over the world to believe in Jesus, to believe in Moses, to believe in Abraham, to believe in Isaac, to believe in Jacob, to believe in Elijah, to believe in Elisha, to believe in Zechariah, to believe in John the Baptist, to believe in Jeremiah, to believe in Ezekiel, to believe in Job, to believe in Jonah, to believe in all the prophets, Israelite prophets, all of them. No Muslim is qualified to be a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus and other Israelite prophets. I hope you understand. And that is why God Almighty says in the Quran, Inna Allah has tafar Adam, God has chosen Adam, wa Nuhan and Noah, wa Ali Ibrahim, and the families of Abraham, of which Jesus was among, Isaac was among, Ishmael was among, Jacob was among, David was among. God said, you know, wa Ali Ibrahim, the families of Abraham, wa Ali Imrana, the families of Imran, Jehoiakim of the Bible, Amran, meaning Jesus, Mary, descended from who? From Imran, Jehoiakim. Hannah was her mother. I hope you understand. So all these prophets, Zuriyat and Ba'aduha bin Ba'ad, they were descended, correlated with one another. That is why the Muslims believe in all of them. So as far as Islam is concerned, Jesus, you know, was the second to the last prophet sent by the Almighty God. And after Jesus, Prophet Muhammad came. So the Muslims believe that before the physical departure of Jesus from this world, he made a prophecy about the coming of a prophet after him, which you, the Christians, call him the Comforter, or the Counselor, or the Helper. We call him Prophet Muhammad, because in the Holy Quran, chapter 61, verse 6, we are told that Jesus said, وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِهِ أَحْمَدُ. I am giving you the good news of a messenger that will come after me. His name is Ahmad. Do you know the meaning of Ahmad? It means the comforter. That is the linguistical meaning of the word Ahmad. The etymological meaning of the word, the literal meaning of the word Ahmad, meaning the comforter. That means the comforter or the counselor. I hope you understand. That is the praised one. I hope you understand. So in a nutshell, if you go back to the Bible, we were asking ourselves, before Jesus left the world, did he make any prophecy about the coming of someone that will come after him?
Yes, sir. He said the comforter will come when I might have gone.
No, listen. I agree with you 100%. Jesus said in the book of John chapter 16 verse 7, it is better for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the comforter will not come. So which means that the comforter will come after Jesus left. And that is also what the Quran says. Remember this Muhammad. After I left, then the comforter will come. You get it? So which means that the Bible, you know, mentioned that Jesus foretold about the coming of another person. Let me put it in full, verbatim. John chapter 16, verses 12 to 14. Jesus said, and I quote, I have yet many things to say unto you that you cannot bear them now. However, when he, mark that word, masculine gender, third person singular, H-E, the spirit of truth, meaning a spiritual man of God. The Bible says the spirit of truth means the prophet of truth in 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 to 2. He said, when he, the spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatsoever he shall hear from God, that is what he will speak. For he will receive of mine, and he will show them unto you, and he will glorify me, and he will show you the judgment to come. How many he? Eight times. Eight masculine genders. I opened my dictionary, Advanced Learner Dictionary at home. I wanted to be sure of the meaning of the pronoun, he. Because I want to confirm what Jesus actually said. So as I opened my dictionary to look at the meaning of the pronoun, he, the Bible translated, the dictionary translated the word he, given the meaning as a male person. A male person. Not she. Not it. But he. As Jesus said, he will not speak when he comes. He will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own authority. But whatsoever he shall hear from God, that is what he will speak. He will receive information about me, and he will pass this information to you. And he will glorify me, and he will show you the judgment to come. Then we ask the Christian, both you and us believe that Jesus made this prophecy. But who was this person? Do you know what the Christians say? They say the Holy Spirit. They say what? The Holy Spirit. We say, yes, you said the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit itself, as Jesus said, when he comes, he will guide you into all the truth. The Holy Spirit himself, you know, will not be working with the Bible, preaching. No. What does the Bible say? How will the Bible, the Holy Spirit, pass the message received from the Almighty God? The Bible explained in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 20 to 21. 2 Peter, please let me read this. 2 Peter. 2 Peter. 2 Peter. Thank you. This is 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 20 to 21. Okay. Look, I want to read it. Check. Okay, let me read it. Come and read it. Check. He said, for no prophecy recorded in scripture was ever taught up by the prophet himself. It was the Holy Spirit within this godly man, meaning this prophet, who gave them true message from God. It was who?
For no prophecy.
Recorded in the scriptures.
Was ever taught of. By the prophet himself. It was the Holy Spirit. Within this godly man.
Meaning within this prophet.
Who gave them the true messages of God.
I want to ask you. Who brought the Quran to Prophet Muhammad?
Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. Is there any evidence? The Quran. Where? Quran chapter 16, verse 102, Surah Al-Nahl. Qul anzalahu ruhul qudus min rabbika bil haqq. Say, anzalahu ruhul qudus min rabbika bil haqq. The Holy Spirit brought down this Quran from God in truth to you, O Muhammad. Meaning, the Holy Spirit was a direct messenger from the Almighty God, who used to bring messages to the chosen men of God. And that was the reason in the prayer of David. You know, the prayer of David in Psalm 51 verse 11, he said, remove not thy Holy Spirit from me. You get it? So this indicates that this Holy Spirit is not the one that will come and start preaching. No, he has to pass the message through a chosen man of God. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam received this inspiration of the Holy Quran. From who? From the Holy Spirit. I hope you understand. So that was the statement of Jesus, that he will not speak on his own authority. But whatsoever he shall hear from God through the Holy Spirit, that is what he will say. So as far as Islam is concerned, Prophet Muhammad was the one that came after the message of Jesus to continue with the message of Jesus. That is why in the Holy Quran, you find the teachings of Jesus. Even the miracles displayed by Jesus, which is not recorded in the Bible, you see it in the Quran. Because according to the Bible, in the book of John chapter 20 verse 30, the Bible says, Jesus did many other miracles, signs and wonders in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in the Bible. Is there a quote? Thank you very much. Then, according to the Quran, the first miracle that Jesus did on earth was to speak to the people. No, according to the Quran, I will come to that of the Bible. According to the Quran, the first miracle that Jesus did on earth was to speak to the people. On the very day Jesus was born, he started speaking. On the very hour that the mother of Jesus delivered him, he was not even circumcised, according to what the Bible says. As a baby, little baby, he started preaching. He started into the Bible. The first miracle that Jesus did was to change water to wine. And how old was he when he performed such miracle? He was 30 years at the beginning of his ministry. Because the ministry of Jesus started when he was what? 30 years. Then according to the Quran, the ministry of Jesus started on the very day he was born. Remember the statement of Jesus there in the book of John chapter 16, verse 12 to 14, that when he comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own authority, but whatsoever he shall hear from God, that is what he will speak. He will receive some information about me, and he will pass this information to you, and he will show you the judgment to come. So this is part of the information. Then in the Quran, we are told about the birth of Mary. How Mary, the mother of Jesus, was born is not in the Bible. Nobody can give you the account on how Mary was born in any of the versions of the Bible, whether the King James Version, or the Revised Standard Version, or the International Bible, or the Living Bible, or the Good News Bible, or the Jehovah's Witness Bible, or the Catholic Bible, or the Catholic-Christian Bible, or the Amplified Bible, or the New English Bible, or the Everyday Bible, or the Lord's Book of the Bible and the Prophet Book of Eden. Nobody can tell you how Mary, the mother of Jesus, was born. But the Quran brought that news on how Mary, the mother of Jesus, even the miracle that happened on the very day she was born, the Quran brought that miracle. Then another miracle performed by Jesus, which is not recorded in the Bible, but is recorded in the Holy Quran, was that the disciples of Jesus told him that they were hungry. They wanted to eat food. They asked him, can your Lord send down a table of food for us from heaven? Can your Lord send down a table of food for us from heaven? Then Jesus said unto them, you should fear God by asking too much of questions about miracles. You ask for this miracle, you ask for that miracle, you ask for that miracle. Then Jesus said, fear God. They said, no. We only wanted to have a taste of that food. We want to eat it. You know, and that our heart will be contented and satisfied that yes, you are a man of God that God sent you. You know, and that we should know that God, that really God has sent you and that you have actually spoken the truth. And that we will also be a witness to that. Then Jesus raised his hand towards the sky. Like this, he raised his two hands. Then he started praying. He said, Allahumma, our Lord, Rabbana, Allahumma, Allah, Rabbana, our Creator, our Lord, Anzil alayna ma'iratin min as-sama. Oh God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, send down a table of food for us from heaven. Show that it will become a solemn festival a celebration for the first of us and the last of us. Wa ayatul minka, and a sign from you. Let it be a sign, a miracle from you. Warzuqna, and provide provision for us. Wa anta khairur raziqin, for you are the best of providers. Then God Almighty responded to Jesus. Allahu inni munazziluha alaykum. I will surely send the food as they requested. As they requested, I will send the food. وَمَنْ يَكْفُرُ بَعْدَ مِنْكُمْ But whosoever disbelieved after that, وَإِنِّي أُعَذِّبُهُ عَذَابًا لَا أُعَذِّبُهُ أَحَدًا مِنَ الْعَالَمِينَ I will surely punish him with a punishment I have never inflicted on any person. Then, immediately Jesus raised his hand, the food was coming, just as they requested. You know, a table of food, you know, two fishes, and five loaves of bread covered with napkin. It was descending until when it descended on the hands of Jesus. And when it descended on the hands of Jesus, Jesus said, Oh Allah, Oh God, Oh Chiniki, Oh Ogeni, Oh Abasi, Oh Olon, Oh Bangidi, Oh El Shaddai, Oh Elohim. He called the name of God. He said, let it be a blessing and not a curse. He prayed for the food. Let it be a blessing and not a curse. Then Jesus blessed it. And he asked the whole people there. They were more than 10,000. He said, oh yeah, we'll now come in. Then they say, how can this small thing, two fishes and a small loaf of bread, how can they be sufficient for all of us here? Jesus said, come and eat it. They started eating, all of them ate to their satisfaction, and they could not finish the food. They could not finish the food. In their very presence, they were seeing when the food was descended. So in a nutshell, God Almighty was performing his miracles through his various prophets for them to be convinced that really God exists and that this prophet we are sent. So Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the final prophet sent by God. With the final testament, because Revelation chapter 14 verses 6 to 7. Gashi, look at it. Now, Aramada, in the next 2 minutes, we listen to you. Now,
Revelation 14
verses 6 to 7.
Verses 6 to 7.
Before you read it, the book, what is the book of Revelation? First, the book of Revelation is the last book of the New Testament. It unveils the things that will take place in the future. That is why it is called what? Revelation. Revelation of things that will take place in the future. Revelation comes after the canonical gospel, gospel according to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and the 14 epistles of Paul, you know, and the other letters. Then Revelation is the last book. Then tell us what Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 to 7 says.
Revelation chapter 14, verse 6. Then I saw an angel.
Then I saw another angel.
Flying in the midst of heaven.
Flying in the midst of heaven, meaning hovering in the sky.
Having the everlasting gospel.
Having the everlasting gospel, meaning good news. Scripture, the everlasting meaning, the gospel that will dwell forever. That is why it is called everlasting gospel.
Having the everlasting gospel to preach to those.
Having the everlasting gospel to preach to those.
Who dwell on the earth.
Who dwell on the earth.
To every nation.
To every nation.
To every nation.
To every nation.
To every tribe.
To every tribe.
To every tongue.
To every tongue, every languages.
And people.
And to every people.
Saying.
Saying.
With a loud voice.
With a loud voice.
Fear God.
Fear God.
And give glory to him.
And give glory to him.
For the hour of his judgment has come.
For the hour of his judgment has come.
And worship him.
And worship him. That is that book will teach you. And worship him.
And worship him.
And worship him.
Who made the heaven.
Who made the heavens.
And earth.
And the earth.
the sea,
the seas,
and
springs
of water.
Of water. Now, we are left with an unanswered question. Now, this is the last book of the Bible. The vision of John. And he said, and I saw an angel flying in the sky, in the heaven, holding, meaning bearing, an everlasting gospel, meaning an everlasting message that will be preached to the people that dwell on earth, to every nation, to every people, to every tribe, to every community, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, and for the hour of his judgment is coming, and worship him that created the heavens, the earth, you know, and the springs of water. Now the question, what is that everlasting gospel? And who was that angel?
It's the messenger now. The angel is the messenger that God sent.
Agreed. The angel is a messenger that God sent. I agree with you 100%. You are on the right track by answering this question.
Oh, yes.
Now we want to see what the angel, when the angel brought that book, what did he see? Open the book of Isaiah. Chapter 29, verse 12.
Isaiah?
Chapter 29, verse 12.
29.
Yes. I agree that the end. Isaiah.
29.
Chapter 29. This is 29. Verse 12. Look for verse 12.
29, verse 12.
Yeah. Okay, listen. Now we want to see what the angel, that angel is a messenger. Yes, I agree.
Then the book.
Which that everlasting gospel, the book,
is delivered to the one.
Is delivered to the one
who is illiterate.
Who is illiterate? He cannot read and he cannot read.
Saying, read this, please.
Read. Then what did he say?
And he says.
And that illiterate person said.
And he says, I am not literate,
meaning I cannot read. Who was that person?
Muhammad.
Thank you, Imam. Prophet Muhammad. A lot of the prophecies of the Bible have been fulfilled, yet people could not perceive that. You know? Now, if not because of you, we will have demonstrated this prayer we used to do everywhere in the world. We were about, you know, conducting the prayer as the Bible says, how the Muslims used to gather in the mosque and pray when you come to ask your question. But what I want you to understand is the teachings of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is a continuation of the teaching of the other prophets that came from the Almighty God. It's just a continuation. That is what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians. Please confirm that from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 9 to 10. 1 Corinthians,
chapter 13.
Verses 9 to 10. 1 Corinthians. Okay, madam, after this, we listen to you, Gashina.
1 Corinthians,
yeah.
Chapter 13.
When I read this verse, I will talk to you.
Verses.
1 Corinthians, this is 2 Corinthians.
1 Corinthians, this verse.
Yeah, what? Chapter 13.
Chapter 13. What?
Verses 9 to 10. Okay, please, listen.
1 Corinthians.
1 Corinthians.
Chapter 13.
Chapter 13. Verses 9.
For we know in part.
For we know in part.
And we prophesy in part.
And we prophesy in part.
But. When that. Which is perfect.
Meaning which is complete.
When that.
Which is perfect.
Has come.
Then.
That which is in part will be done away.
Do we understand this prophecy?
Yes.
For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is complete come, when that which is perfect come, the incomplete one will be kept aside. Which means that the Bible is telling us about the coming of another revelation after the gospel of Jesus. And that was the reason why Jesus said, when the Comforter comes, he will guide you into all the truth. And Jesus gave that as one of the indications of the hour. In Matthew chapter 24, verse 14, when he was given the sign of the hour, nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. Then he said that, and the gospel of the everlasting, you know, the gospel of the everlasting kingdom will be preached to all the nations as a witness to all the nations before the end will come. Father, Madam, over to you.
Mama is a Christian, you're welcome. Yes. You have a question? Okay, straight to the question, please.
Praise the Lord. Is there any Christian around us here? My question comes like this. I was in the, I'm a market woman selling in the market here.
Yeah.
So all what they are saying, I've heard everything they are saying. Yeah. And my question goes to the communities. But they say there is not, I am asking this question. And I heard that it's a pastor in the midst of the Muslims here.
Yeah.
And that is the reason why I think it's time that I will come here and ask the pastor that question. My Christian brother, you are a pastor, as I heard in my shop. And the question comes to you. So you say there is no Trinity as a Christian. That is my question. DSC, this is most of DSC, and I'm a Christian in DSC, and I bring this question to you. I want you to give me that answer. Since you say there is no Trinity in Christianity, my question is this.
Let me tell you, madam, you just asked a question, right? Every man with their own belief. When we said Trinity, I am not telling that. Because according to the Bible, it did not even Jesus wrote his letter like that. His power with his father are not the same. So some persons strongly believe, some persons they strongly believe that. Now, Mama, some persons they strongly believe that Trinity is one God, that God the Father, God the Son. As the same Bible people understand that the Holy Spirit is a messenger. It's a messenger that God sends to meet men's needs. You go and deliver souls present. You understand? So that way you are looking at it, Trinity is not that. It's something some person strongly hold to say three God. But I'm telling you, as a member of my denomination, we believe that there's Trinity, but there are not. This Trinity doesn't make one God. It is God the Father on his own, God the Son on his own. Then the Holy Spirit is a messenger. Do you know in the same book of Acts, he said, you are even greater than the Holy Spirit.
Thank you very much.
We are all children of God.
Yeah.
And we always learn every day. Like my brother said, he says some believe in Trinity. When some do not believe in Trinity.
Yeah.
But I want to let you know today, Trinity is one. As a Christian, God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit, they are one working together. As the Bible teach me to say, the word is not my word. The word is for the Bible. When I'm saying this, some people may be mocking, some people may be laughing. But the word is not my word. I saw it in Bible, and I hold him. That is what I'm worshiping. And another question comes to the past also. He said Jesus is not the mother of Redeemer. That question I saw, I hear the word in my shop.
Mary
is not the mother of a Redeemer. And I want to declare to the whole world and the whole Muslim that Mary is the mother of a Redeemer. What them teach me as a Christian and what I add in my Bible and what I read in my Bible. Mary is the mother of a Redeemer. You cannot say Mary is not the mother of a Redeemer.
No, express yourself very well, please.
That is my question I'm asking our pastor. My brother Muslim, I am not accusing you people. It's what my brother preached here.
Okay.
What? I did not say Mary is not important. Mary gave birth to Jesus Christ.
Let me tell you, ma'am. You are misunderstanding the whole issue. I did not tell you that Mary is not. Is did someone not give birth to Christ while he was on the earth carrying up his yes, ma'am. Mary, listen, let me tell you, is the way you people look at it, the way Catholics, the way you are sounding, it is clerically sure that you are a Catholic. You are a Catholic.
Thank God I'm not a Catholic.
But the way you are saying, because let me tell you, listen now, we don't come here to argue. The brother on my side just said something. He said the way I handle, I'm telling you according to the way I've been taught in the Bible school. Mary is the mother of Christ, fine. But that does not, you know, some places, if you go to some places, you see some people, they even honor the Mary more than Jesus Christ. They honor Mary more than Jesus Christ. Then what we are saying in that church, Mary is not God. There's some people, they call her God. Mary is somebody that found favor from the sight of God.
She
find favor from the sight of God. Doesn't make her automatic God. Then that, for that angle, I'm coming now. Then the brother that stand by me, I did not tell you that Trinity does not exist, but I want to make you clear that Trinity we are talking about, you say Trinity, then you are equally telling us that the Holy Spirit is in God. Then when Bible says in the beginning was God, in the book of Matthew, the beginning was God and God was with God. Did he say there was order for submitted with him?
Hello,
let me tell you, I'm coming now, so that you not go that. There's one redeem that is criticized. No, what I'm telling you now today, listen and listen clearly, man. Mary is mother of Christ, but that does not give you an epitome to start honoring her more than Jesus Christ, the Savior. Thank you.
Yeah. We are all learning.
Yeah.
Unless somebody that is angry.
Yeah.
About the word of God, we always learn each day.
Yeah.
And we learn from one another.
Yeah.
That is the reason why God said, let's come and reason together.
Yeah.
Your own sense and my own is not the same.
Yeah.
And you will bring your own, our brother will come, my own will come. We will now learn something out of him.
Exactly.
That is what our Father Jesus taught us. We should come together. Like how you people come together like this. You people are reasoning together. And you will go on with something. That is the reason why you are here. But my brother, what I'm telling my brother, like the way he mentioned concerning the mother of our Redeemer, I am an Anglican. Let me just clear it for you today. I am not a Catholic. And this Catholic people that is worshipping Christian, mentioning Mary, they did not take Mary as their Lord. They honor him as the mother of Redeemer. He just like, as I'm a woman today in the house, I have an husband and children. My children will respect me as a mother. And my husband will respect me as a wife. And I give the honor to my husband. That is the reason why all the Catholic Church are giving that woman the respect to bring our Redeemer to be the mother of our Redeemer. They never worship him. My brother, that is what I want to claim. Not I come here to quarrel with anybody or to make any issue with anybody. So I drop my word here and I bring thanks to everybody. And I bless every one of us in the name of Jesus. Praise the Lord!
Knowledge is power, and we are here to share knowledge, so that we have peace, and we follow the grit from God, whom none of us have ever seen. And what he said was so simple, love your neighbor as thyself. Religion is not to create confusion. I grew up in the midst of all the religion. The Babalangos were there. Muslims were there. Christians were there. If I keep acting my conscience, it led us from the carnival situation, the issue of corruption, the issue of criminality, the issue of insecurity, the issue of freedom.
You have asked a very good question. Look, all human beings, irrespective of their language, race, color, or geographical location, We all agree that God Almighty created us. I hope you understand. But what is the purpose of our creation? Why did God Almighty create us? God said in the Quran, He created the jinn and men in order to acknowledge Him as God and worship Him. Do you get that point? The purpose of our creation is to do what? To worship God and follow the commandments of God. Now the question, how do we worship God? Do we worship God the way we want to serve and worship God? Or do we worship God the way God Almighty wants us to worship Him? Mr. Benga, do we worship God the way we want to worship God? Or do we worship God the way God Almighty wants us to worship Him?
I love that. That is a very technical question. Because I don't know how God wants me to worship Him. The question is this.
No, you know.
I don't know, sir. I have only three books to consult. I have the Quran to consult. I have the Bible to consult. I have the traditional book to consult. Depending on who is teaching me. In Africa today, we have three principal historians. Adu Fuen from Ghana. Adi Mansuru from Egypt and Adi Agai from Lebanon. Excuse me. The three people, if they write about Ghana Empire, Tonga Empire, Sudan Empire, from different perspectives. So how do I know? How do I know?
You know which religion do you belong to?
Sir?
Which do you believe in the Bible?
I believe in the Bible.
You believe in the Bible?
Yes.
Okay, now if you don't thank you. Now, I will show you how God wants us to worship Him. When God wanted us to worship Him, He sent His prophet to teach us how we should worship Him. How we should do what?
Worship Him.
Now, I want to show Him how to worship God.
In the Bible.
In the Bible. Open the book of Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 2.
You don't
miss the teaching of the Bible with traditional religion. The figment of the imagination. You should not be hypocritical in your worship. You should be straightforward. You get it? Fire?
Nehemiah chapter 8.
Please, verse 4. Whenever I call you, just come. Fire? Chapter 8. Fire? Start reading.
Verse 4.
To 6.
So the
chapter 4. Chapter 8, verse 4. To 6. Okay.
His right hand side.
At his right hand. This is my right hand. Assuming I am Ezra. This is my right hand.
Stood.
Matitia. Fire?
Shema.
Shema, where is Shema? Don't match you.
Anania.
My friend, another person.
Horija.
Horija, next person, Horija. Stand there, please give chance.
Halkia.
Halkia, where is Halkia? Stand there.
Hashem.
Move the bench.
Hashem.
Oya, stop like that. Stop naming them like that. Oya. Because there is no space.
And Ezra.
Open the book.
In the sight of all the people.
In the sight of all the people.
For he was standing. Above all the people.
Meaning he was in front of them.
And when he opened it. And all the people stood up.
They are already standing. Because it begins with Simon. They are already standing.
And Ezra blessed the Lord.
Let me bless the Lord and also translate what I say. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen.
الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Stop there. What happened there?
Then all people answered, Amen. Amen.
Is that the word they answer? Then let me translate what I say. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful, all praises be unto Allah, the Lord of the world, the most beneficent, the most merciful, the master of the day of judgment. You alone we worship, and you alone we ask for help. Guide us onto the straight path, the path of those whom you have shown your favor, not the path of those who are your anger, and not the path of those who go astray. And then what happened?
While lifting up your hands,
Allahu Akbar, God is the greatest.
And they bowed their heads.
Allahu Akbar, they bowed their heads.
And worshiped Lord with their faces.
And worshiped the Lord with their faces. Sami Allahu liman hamidahu.
On the ground. Mr. Benga.
Listen. That is how to worship God in the Bible. Do you know the evidence? If you go back to the book of Isaiah chapter 45, verse 23, he said, I have sworn by myself, from my mouth has gone forth a word that shall not return. Unto me, every knee shall bow. Every knee shall bow. And as a result of that, what happened to Jesus? Matthew chapter 26, verse 39. Jesus fell down on his face and he worshiped the Almighty God, the way the Muslims do. What happened to Abraham? Genesis chapter 17, verse 3. Abraham fell down on his face the way the Muslims do, and he worshiped the Almighty God. What happened to Moses and Aaron? Moses and Aaron, according to the book of Numbers, chapter 20, verses 5 to 6, Moses and Aaron fell down on their faces as they served and worshiped the Almighty God. Daniel, according to the book of Daniel, chapter 6, verse 10, in the Bible, Daniel fell down on his face and he served and worshiped the Almighty God. What about the angels? The angels of the Almighty God, according to the book of Revelation, chapter 11, verse 16, the Bible says that all the angels of God, behind the throne of God, fell down on their faces. They prostrated with their faces to the ground and served and worshiped the Almighty God. Therefore, if you don't have a book that teaches you how to serve and worship God, we have it.
Mr. Gwenda.
God Almighty created us in order to serve and worship Him. And secondly, Mr. Benga, you give one example that the fact that I am a Muslim does not mean that my son, you are a Muslim. You get it. For example, I will give you an example with Abraham. The father of Abraham was not a Muslim. He was an idol worshiper, Azara, as we are told in the Quran. And Abraham even preached to his father. You know, Abraham, his father, was not a Muslim, but he himself was a Muslim and even a prophet of God. And Abraham invited him to stop worshiping idols. He refused. So, religion, Islam, is based on conviction for you to know. You know, to apply that knowledge, divine knowledge, of knowing the Almighty God. It does not mean that if your father is a Habanist, you must be a Habanist. No. You get it? So, you are allowed to go and search. That is why Jesus said in the book of John chapter 8, verse 32, seek ye the truth, and the truth shall set you free. And he said in Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 to 10, he said, ask and it shall be given unto you. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. Seek and ye shall find. So you are not allowed to remain like that. You need to seek for what? To seek for knowledge. Because the Bible says in Hosea chapter 4, verses, that for people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. You get it? So therefore, what other example did he bring again in his presentation?
Yes, it's clear now. I think it's clear.
Then issue, excuse me. Before I wanted to say something, I will have
I didn't know, you know, because the woman that came here,
Mama,
she did not refer, yes,
the
respected woman, I respect her so much,
yes,
because she was bold enough and confident enough to come and ask
exactly.
And remove that thing that is worrying her in her mind.
Yes.
Whatever is worrying you in your mind, vomit it out, don't leave it there because it will spoil your heart. You know, don't express your anger. Tell the people, you have looked what you have done, I don't like it. Because if you leave it, it will start eating your liver. You will be frustrated and fall down. So in a notion, I would have wanted to ask her, because immediately she come here, she was mentioning Trinity, T-R-I-N-I-T-Y, Trinity. I want to ask her whether she has seen a word called Trinity in the Bible. Trinity.
Trinity in the Bible.
T-R-I-N-I-T-Y. You can never find that verse, that statement, Trinity in the Bible. Where does it come from? Where did she get that word? Trinity is nowhere in the Bible. The word Trinity is absent in the Bible. Nowhere Jesus mentioned the word Trinity. That word, you know, is nowhere to be found. If she knows the origin of the dogma of Trinity, the origin of what? The dogma of Trinity. From the pagan mythological doctrine, dogma, in Rome, it was established in about 325 AD under Bishop Athanasius. You know, and you know that the conference was conducted by Constantine. Constantine, at that time, they were the one that concocted this dogma of Trinity. So the dogma of Trinity was formulated in the year 325, you know, AD, during the Council of, you know, Nicaea in Rome. It is not a biblical teaching.
Somebody here.
That is why anything that creates confusion, God is not the author of confusion. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse what? Verse 34. God is not the author of, verse 33. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. That is 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 33. Then in verse 34, it says, as in all the churches of the saints, let your women keep silent in the church, for they are not commanded to speak, but they are subject to be under obedience. If they would seek for any knowledge, let them ask their husband at home. So, in a nutshell, just as the madam said, we are here to share knowledge. You know, our time is fast approaching for the breaking of our fast. And if we have enough time, this fasting, you see now, we are in the fasting period. We fast for how many days? 29 or 30 days, go, depending on the sighting of the crescent. This fasting in the month of Ramadan, even the month of Ramadan, is in the Bible.
No time.
It's in the Bible. The Muslim fasting is in the Bible. Complete fasting.
Okay, just give us the verse in the Bible.
That is the book of Jeremiah. That is in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 36, verse 9. If somebody wants to, yes. Jeremiah chapter 36, verse 9, read it. When I translate it, then.
Jeremiah says,
yeah, chapter 36, verse 9.
Pastor Gabriel, what do you read?
I cannot have one. Okay, this is Jeremiah chapter 36.
Jeremiah 36.
Listen, Jeremiah chapter 36, verse 9, the fasting in the month of Ramadan. Shahru Ramadan and Ladi Ozilasi Hil Quran. Ramadan in the Bible. Ramadan fasting in the Bible. Verse 9.
Verse 9.
Yes, listen, the Bible. We are reading the Bible. Uh-huh.
Now it came to pass. In the fifth year of.
In the fifth year.
Of Jehoiakim.
Of Jehoiakim.
The son of Josiah.
The son of Joshua.
King of Judah.
King of Judah.
In the ninth month.
In the ninth month. Before you go further, please. Ramadan. What month is that? Is it the ninth month? Ninth month of the Islamic calendar. This month we are now. In the ninth what?
In the ninth month.
In the ninth month, which is Ramadan. Nine month.
In the ninth month.
In the ninth month.
That they proclaim a fast.
That they proclaim a fast.
Before the Lord.
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 To all people.
To all the people.
In Jerusalem.
In Jerusalem. Continue.
In DRC.
In Jerusalem.
In Nigeria.
In Nigeria.
In Jerusalem.
To all the people in Jerusalem.
And to all the people.
And to all the people.
Who came from the cities.
Who came from the city.
Of Judah.
Of Judah.
To Jerusalem.
To Jerusalem. That means the stranger. In the nine-born, fasting was proclaimed for the whole people of Jerusalem. You know, and the people of Judah and the strangers. And what is the nine-born? Ramadan. يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام.
يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون.
الحمد لله.
يا أيها الذين آمنوا all you believers كتب عليكم الصيام fasting has been proclaimed or prescribed for you كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم. Just as it was prescribed for the people that existed before you. Now Allah will test the fool so that you will learn self-righteousness or you will have the fear of the Almighty Allah. We don't have enough time because we come from Ipapli and we have to go and break our fast.
We thank Allah.
What we are thinking now is how to approach God. Is that what we are saying? Are we approaching God through Jesus Christ? Are we approaching God through Muhammad? I've read, and I'm happy as soon as I came here, I met two principal persons that have loved me so much. They are not Christians. One is sitting down here. He said, I'm happy to have known. There's another officer there. It's Elijah. Anytime he wants to put me in his car, he's not asking whether I'm a Christian or a Muslim. I like it there. Anytime he wants to ask me something, he doesn't ask me whether I'm Christian or anything. He does it according to love, which is what God represents. God is not a debater. God does not debate. It's not what he wants. Do you love me and do you love your neighbor? And sister, the three S of God has been discussed. We are not part of the things we are sent to go and do. I see, I see, we are coming. If I am Benga, I will have my father's name into Richard. Benga Fasuji. My father had his own father's name to reach.
Mr. Benga.
Excuse me, sir.
You said question.
Excuse me, sir. I'm asking question. I'm asking question.